of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
Invited guest, our keynote speaker and guest lecturer. Good afternoon. My name is Olakisi Ajiboye, a senior advisor at RTC Advisory Services Limited, and I will be the MC of this event. It is with great pleasure that we welcome you all to this book presentation event commemorating the 50th birthday celebration of our dear friend, colleagues, and partner in progress, Mr. Opeyemi Agbaje. We are elated by the presence of people from all walks of life who are here today. Our sincere gratitude goes to God Almighty for making this possible, and special thanks to you all for honoring our invitation despite your tight schedules and commitments. Marcus Tullius Cicero, widely considered one of the greatest orators and most versatile minds of ancient Rome, summed it up when he said, "Gratitude is not only the greatest of virtues, but the parent of all others." We deeply appreciate your presence and support. We are here today because of Mr. Opeyemi Agbaje, who in some way is important to each of us. Certainly, many of us must have interacted with him personally and not professionally through his column on TV or through his unceasing act of public advocacy. And we can attest to his intellect, commitment, passion, and professionalism, and his devotion to making Nigeria a better place in terms of business environment, strategy, policy, and economy and governance. This event will feature the launch of two new books authored by him, titled Uncomplex Strategy, Making Business Strategy Accessible to Managers, Entrepreneurs, and Students, and Democracy Without Democrats, Travels of Politics and Development in Nigeria between 1999 to 2011. The book offers a focus on strategy, business strategy, and governance issues in a developing economy. There will be a panel discussion on business strategy by a panel of four leading CEOs in finance, ICT and payments, development banking, agribusiness, and private equity, and a lecture titled Democracy and Governance in Nigeria, to be presented by a distinguished professional politician and leader, Mr. Jimmy Agbaje. Once again, we thank you for accepting our invitation and making out time to attend this event in honor of Mr. Opeyemi Agbaje. We welcome you all. Without further ado, we shall proceed to the first part of the program, which is the panel discussion. And the topic is business strategy in Nigeria. And to do justice to this topic, our experts with vast experience in financial services, banking, in insurance and development banking, private equity, and ICT. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the podium the Managing Director and Chief Executive Officer, Bank of Industry Limited, Mr. Rashid Olaoluwa. Also welcome the Chief Client Officer, Mansard Insurance, Mr. Tosin Rushewe. Please join me in welcoming the Managing Director, CEO, Digital Jewels Limited, a leading ICT consultancy, Mrs. Doyin Odunfa. Also welcome the Managing Director, Chief Executive Officer, Sahid Capital, Mr. Mezu Umuneli. To moderate this session is no other than the one who knows how to do it best. Please welcome the Managing Director, Chief Executive Officer, RTC Advisory Services Limited, Mr. Opeyemi Agbaje.
Once again, I thank you all for making time out to attend this event. I choose to do the things I enjoy on this day and to indulge in my passions, which are business strategy and issues around democracy, policy, governance, and all of that. But first of all, this panel. I thank the panel. You know all of them, they're very well known, but I'll just talk very briefly about what each person brings to the discussion. Their profiles are in the booklet you have, so we save time. But Mezo is CEO of Sahel Capital, is private equity, but he's focused on agriculture, and he's set up a fund called FAFIN, Fund for Agriculture in Nigeria, and sponsored by global and international and the Nigerian Ministry of Agriculture and the Ministry of Finance. So he brings, and of course, he's also set up, he's an investor in agribusiness. He's set up East Foods Limited. So he brings some insight into the issues around agriculture, agriculture finance, and all of that. Of course, Rashid Olaoluwa, my colleague in banking for decades. He's a hardcore banker, but he has also gone into the investment finance space, investment banking space at UBA Capital, indeed long before that at ARM, and more recently he's in the field of industry, SMEs, financing industrialization in Nigeria as CEO of Bank of Industry. Tosin Rushewe also happens to be a very good colleague. Back in the years, he started in core banking, but he's moved into the non-bank side of things for some years now, in the areas of insurance and indeed management, asset management, investment management. And I know that more recently he's also got into the health management space. So he brings unique insights. And of course, I don't think we were gentlemanly. We put the lady to the extreme, which was not the plan, but I apologize, Doyin. Doyin is probably one of the most, the strongest voices in the area of technology in Nigeria. She's been a consultant in IT, and she set up her own business around information technology, payment systems, internet security, and all of those issues. And she brings that perspective to the discussions that we're going to have today. So that's the panel. But just to set it off, I'll tend to take it in one direction or the other. I'll ask each of the panelists to reflect on the last decade in their sectors, in their areas of focus, and highlight those issues they found that have been significant changes in the business environment, significant changes in the structure of their industries. What are the trends that they found most striking, and to reflect on all what all of that has meant for business in Nigeria. So I'll start with Mezo.
Thank you very much, Opeyemi, and happy birthday. I think one of the industries in Nigeria that's had one of the greatest changes of the past 10 years has definitely been the agricultural sector. 10 years ago, if you asked somebody what their career path was and they said that they were in agribusiness in some form, I think most people would be shocked, surprised, and think something was wrong or they had a bad stroke of luck. That's why they went into farming. And today, it's a very different viewpoint. And if you look value chain by value chain across sectors, there have been huge changes. Let's start with cassava, which has been highly publicized. Roughly 10 odd years ago, there were initial policies to promote high quality cassava flour inclusion in flour in Nigeria. Policies came, they were rolled back. And then the mills that were set up around that time closed down. The past 4 or 5 years, there's been renewed impetus within the sector. There's been more credible policies put in place. You have substantial investments that have been done even broadly away from cassava flour into starch. There are players looking at sweeteners. And these are products that feed into a broad range of companies and industries that many of you are aware of. They feed into Nestle, they feed into Nigerian Breweries, they feed into Unilever, and this is cassava starch that many people don't realize are used by this sector. You look at oil palm, the amount of land under cultivation for palm in Asia, there's only a limited amount of land. There are very few places in the world you can grow oil palm. Nigeria is one of those few places, which means that as demand grows for oil palm related products, one of the few places to grow it is Nigeria, and also one of the largest markets as well to consume that product is Nigeria, so there's more opportunity here. If you look at the types of people who are moving into this sector, you have former corporate Nigeria professionals, younger people looking at agribusiness in some form or the other, and realizing that agribusiness is not farming with a hoe, but it's large-scale rice projects in Anambra states, like my friend, is involved in its 2,000-3,000 hectare oil palm projects. It's large scale animal feed plants. And you have younger professionals moving to this space, which was unheard of many years ago. I'll pause there and then go into more detail on other topics later.
I don't know what Rashid will talk about. Is it banking? Is it development finance? But you can take them all. Just please to those areas in which you have some thoughts.
Okay, thanks, Opeyemi, and happy 50th birthday in advance. I know the actual date is on Monday. And thanks for this opportunity. Let me start with banking generally in Nigeria. And I think banking has undergone tremendous changes in the last decade, especially starting from the banking industry consolidation in 2004, leading to the evolution of what I call 20 strong banks. Before then, domestic banks couldn't even muster the strength to finance anything close to a mega transaction. But today we find Nigerian banks facing transactions in their billions. And that's a significant development. We used to, rely on a lot of foreign banks, to come and really lead syndications, for our domestic transactions. Now we're able to do that. A lot of the banks have also become, very strong in terms of their institutional capacity building. They're very strong in risk management. They are strong in terms of the skill of their employees. They're strong in terms of, technology adoption, and that has also helped to improve service delivery, across the board. If I may just touch on the development banking space, briefly. I think that we've had a lot of start-stop, kind of scenario in development banking. A new development bank is set up, it is funded, and over time, loans are granted that go bad, and then they go back to square one. I think, but what we have seen in the case of the Bank of Industry is that we have a model that appears to be succeeding. If you look at our interventions, in industry, in SMEs, up till 2009, cumulative disbursement of loans, was less than 30 billion naira. But between 2009 to date, we're looking at about 800 billion. So there has been significant development in that area. What we're working on right now is to make sure that we can actually sustain, that momentum, to make sure that we have an institution that can last, an institution that can survive, CEOs. The CEOs can come and go, and the institution remains, that can ensure that when loans are granted, the loans are repaid, that can ensure that, the technology is adopted, that can ensure that, the institution is properly run, in terms of governance, compliance, and so on and so forth. So these are things that we are doing to make changes.
Thank you. Okay, thank you, Ashid. I'll skip to Sing and start with doing in terms of the technology space over the last decade. I know it's been busy, but you've been involved in everything. So give us a view of the most significant changes and how the space has evolved.
Okay, thank you very much. I think if you look at technology, without a doubt, it is a game changer. And I think we see that very much in Nigeria. We see the developments that technology has made possible. If you look at the last 5 years, indeed, even if we don't stretch to 10 years, you see a situation where in our banking system, checks have moved from a T plus 3 to T plus 1 clearing system today. We see that according to the MCT figures, ICT is now contributing about 9.5% to our GDP, up from 5.5% about 4 years ago. We see a situation where internet penetration now is about 70 million people. It's been growing double digits in the last 7 years, 20-something percent each year. We see a situation where the ubiquity of technology, we see what has happened in the telecom sector. We see how many people today are able to benefit from communications, not just voice, but data. We see a situation where we've moved from having only a SAT-1, submarine cable to now 5 different cables that are berthing on the shores of Nigeria. Yes, we still have the last mile challenge, but it clearly means that a lot more people have access. We see a situation where, whether you are looking at it as an individual or you're looking at it as a business, the impact has been pervasive. So if you look at it as an individual, we all know how much you can do from your homes today without getting out of your homes. We know what kind of payments, whether it's your DSTV or your prepaid NEPA bills or whatever. All of these things you can do without leaving your house. And so that sort of touches also on the developments in the e-payment systems, which has been very, very extensive. With the CBN pushing cashless Nigeria, the proliferation of e-delivery channels, as an institution or as a government, we also see the impact. We see improved efficiency if it's done well. We see improved velocity of money. We see the promise of financial inclusion being more real to us. So generally, it's had a very, very far-reaching impact. I don't think that as a business or as a government today, you can talk about being effective without using IT effectively. So whichever level you want to look at it on, whether personal, professional, institutional, government, the picture 10 years ago to the picture today has been incredible. Now, of course, along with that comes with some undesirable effects, which include, or which is most notably, the cybersecurity and the information security breaches. So then, you know, it's been a double-edged sword, but I would say from my own viewpoint, the benefits of adopting information technology in Nigeria have far outstripped the challenges. So today we probably have one of the most efficient banking systems, you know, the telecoms organizations and so on, you know. So I'll stop there for now.
Okay, we'll go into some more detail with Doyin on those issues around the risks of IT and all of that. But Tosin, I mean, you've spanned both the core financial banking and now pioneered health management, insurance, building. What has struck you around that as the most significant evolutions and changes that we should reckon with?
Thanks, Opeyemi, and happy birthday to you. Over the last decade or so, we have seen the insurance industry in Nigeria grow quite significantly. I think we've seen a compound annual growth rate of about 17% over the last decade. But more importantly, we have seen a much more credible insurance industry evolve. 10, 11, 12 years ago, people paid for insurance only when they absolutely had to, and even at that, they probably thought it was more like paying tax. They didn't really expect to get anything out of it, even if they had a claim, and if they had a claim, they didn't bother to report it. Service, on the average, was generally very poor. But today, we have seen a number of very strong, very credible insurance companies evolve. Very strong, balance sheet much bigger. And I think in 2013 alone, the industry paid claims in excess of 86 billion naira. And so today, I think we're beginning to see less and less fights on the road where people have motor accidents and people are simply exchanging documents. But beyond that, we have also seen the industry sort of like evolve in different directions. We've seen the government regulators take out the pension system and out of the insurance industry and create a separate industry altogether. And of course, that particular sector has grown far faster than literally every other sector in financial services. We are also witnessing, you know, the evolution of the health insurance space, which is still much smaller. But if you look at all of the macroeconomic indices and you look at the economy itself, it's very clear that this is probably the only way we can pay for provision of medical care in Nigeria. The government is not going to pay for it, I don't think so. And so we have to evolve these, you know, means of pulling funds together, not just to pay for the service, but also perhaps to transform the providers, the hospitals, because that's really the ultimate, you know, in service delivery. For the life of general insurance, especially the general insurance, 11 years ago, there was a dominant player, for example, you know, that had 25% market share, government owned, and today, you know, it's simply not there, not there at all. And you have new leaders in the market. The company that leads the market today with 14% market share was number 5, you know, 11 years ago, now it's number 1. So we've seen a transformation of the top players in that industry. As people begin to ask for value, they're really looking for real value. And as these companies have also started to offer real value, and they're not just, you know, there providing, you know, plain vanilla, you know, services. But maybe I'll hold on.
Thank you very much, Tosin. Tosin took us into the next domain of the discussions, which is about firms and winners and losers. And he's given, without mentioning names, one sector in which there was a loser. So my general question to the panel is, if we look at sectors and we look at who has won or who has lost, what has tended in that particular, in that particular industry context? What factors have tended to account for who wins or who loses, who gets to be number one, or who drops out of the race? I will find this a very interesting discussion, first in the context of banking. So I'll draw Rashid. into this. So what factors have, in your view, have tended to drive leadership success, and what factors have accounted for failure?
Thanks. I think the first factor that comes to mind is technology, and technology in various forms. So let's take payment systems, for instance. The Nigerian payment system has been radically transformed in the last 10 years. I used to be on the board of InterSwitch in 2004, and I know that InterSwitch was, that time, a loss-making business that was struggling to even meet up with expenses. But today, InterSwitch is a company that is worth, God knows, 40, 50 billion naira. It's doing very well because Nigeria has transited, you know, successfully into almost a cashless society. When the Central Bank of Nigeria introduced the cashless policy, I mean, they got a lot of clams in terms of, oh, this is not going to work. But today, Nigeria is, you know, essentially a cashless society. Now, banks that have moved and positioned themselves, you know, very well to be able to play, you know, in this area in terms of, you know, electronic payments, in terms of, you know, ATMs, in terms of mobile banking, you know, have become winners in this area. So for me, those are clear indicators.
Okay. Amezo, the agri space, or indeed even private equity space, what factors have driven success and failure?
There are a couple, I think, commonalities across sectors, and there are a couple things that are distinct. In terms of what goes across sectors, especially if you start with SMEs that then go into larger companies, I think what you see as companies grow is you have the founders, the team building the companies, and at some point they need to transition into proper institutional structures. And as companies grow through different phases, they need to transition. And those firms and groups that are willing to bring in quality management, quality people, putting governance in place, are able then to then transition to get into much larger entities. And I think for many firms, it's actually hard to do. To go from entrepreneurs, owners, relinquishing control to a team, and then the willingness to put in control, which effectively puts in governance, which effectively implies paying taxes, which eventually implies reporting more of your performance, which is hard to do in this environment. I think looking at the agriculture sector more specifically, I think there are two parts of it that are critical. One is your supply chain, because you're getting materials effectively from the farmers. And if you don't have a robust supply chain to get that material, you can't get competitive price product to compete. The second part is actually on the distribution side, making sure the product actually gets to your customers, which is actually tougher than it seems. If you look at many of the large distributors in Nigeria, they will only carry imported products. They will not carry local products. So if you're a local firm building capacity, you cannot plug into existing networks. You need to build your own distribution chains, which is extremely tough. So for those that are able to now do that, build that capacity, and now get to the point where customers are demanding your products, so that the larger established logistics companies then are willing to pull your products, it takes time to build and is a critical success factor. So those two pieces, supply chain and distribution, are key in this space.
Rashid said technology. So in deployment of technology, what has enabled some firms to succeed and some to fail? I see a lot of technology purchase. But in terms of effectiveness, what factors do you think account for success and failure?
Okay, thank you. So it's not technology in a vacuum or technology just for the sake of technology. In my view, it's first of all starting from, you know, business strategy. Really, what does your business do? Do you have an understanding of your value chain? Where does your business create the most value? Because that's where you want to support that business most with technology. You know, and then as you progress and as you mature, you want to automate as many of your processes as possible. You know, so that understanding is really critical. And so when people go into the adoption of technology, implementation of technology solutions without an understanding of how it adds value to their business, they will run into trouble. Beyond that, you obviously have to select the right type of technologies. You have to implement them effectively. You have to have effective skills, both technology and project management skills, to see it through. You know, so I would say that those are probably the key factors that will ensure that you don't lose. I mean, lots of people have spent money on technology. Some of them are better, some of them are not better. Indeed, in this day and age, I sort of assume that the technology will work. So it's not really the technology, it's how you go about it. Are you supporting your business in the right place with technology? So for example, I mean, is it R&D, is it distribution, is it manufacturing? Where really does your business have the most value? And then you move that argument forward to say, if it's in this area, what are the best types of, you know, systems that I can use? So most people today, most of the large industries have automated fully their core transaction processing systems, if you can say, put it that way, and then you extend it to your payment systems, and then you extend it to your support systems, and you want to make sure that it's integrated, so that you don't sort of have islands of technology, because again, that can create a lot of incompatibility problems, which can just be a nightmare. So having that clear plan of this technology development, and I think one of the advantages we have in Nigeria clearly is because we're starting a bit late, we don't have the challenges of legacy technology, which the developed countries are sort of fighting with now.
Let me ask you a follow-on question. With respect to Nigerian technology businesses, so which firms have done well? Not by name, but what have they tended to do? And what have those who done not so well not done? Now firms engaged in the technology space.
So clearly the starting point will be, what is the business need? You know, so some people come up with great solutions, but you're asking them, so what problem is this supposed to solve? So a clear understanding of what business needs that you're trying to address. And then of course, I mean, things like access to capital, access to the market, you know. So there have been some initiatives, private and public sector, to just ease some of those pains. But really, those people who have been winners have focused on areas of growth. Okay, because you can't grow faster than the sector that you're focusing on. So you will see a lot of growth in e-payments, both in terms of devices, in terms of the solutions, so whether it's hardware or software, the communications that go around payment systems. Most of the software, unfortunately, has been sourced from outside the country, so a lot of that money is going out. But I know there are a number of initiatives to try and address that currently. And then you see, of course, the professional services that you need to put everything together. Beyond payment systems, there's been a lot of developments in social media as well. You know, social media platforms and the enablement and the access to those platforms. So clearly, the people who are providing communications, last mile, are also in an area of growth, because now that we've got all those fat cables, you know, fat pipes, the next thing is, how do they actually get it to the last, to the, you know, the actual user? So the people who are able to come up with solutions that are costless and faster to deploy, obviously will be winners, you know. So there's a broad spectrum, but I'll just say those are key areas of growth currently today.
Thank you. Tosin, back to you. You led us into this conversation around success and failure. And there's no mystery about Nikon in your industry, and firms like yours and Leadway and some of the others who have done well. So in your view, and I know you probably have very well developed views of this, what factors led some out of the league tables, and what factors shot some up the table?
Thanks, Opeyemi. For like you, I have to avoid mentioning the names. My legal head of legal department is flashing at me at the back of the room. So I think two factors I would like to examine. And the first is leadership. Leadership from the context of vision, understanding exactly where, you know, the business is meant to be headed, and how to get there, what resources are needed to take the business from point A to point B, and why it is important to actually go in the direction of point B and not point C or point D. I think for me, this is really possibly the most important, you know, of all the factors. But the second factor I'd like to talk about, I think, is the one that you mentioned, which is the value chain. I think it's in the insurance sector, it's been absolutely critical to understand the value chain and to understand, you know, who is taking what, you know, from the value chain. There was a period, 11, 12 years ago in this industry where, distribution channel, the broken distribution channel probably, took, 80-90% of the value chain because the underwriters had more or less abdicated responsibility, over a long period of time before this. And I think the companies that have done well over the last decade or so are companies that have done their analysis, I have come to understand the value chain, and I've come to carry out a number of activities that have enabled them to get an increasing share of that value chain. And they've done this through a number of ways, through innovation, product innovation, service innovation, expansion of distribution channels, and diversifying distribution away from a single distribution channel into multi-channels, whether you're talking about increasing their own footprint from their own branches, bank, insurance, electronic, etc., etc. And they have also learned to create value, unique value, to the customers, and therefore have differentiated themselves in many ways. So if we look at the top 10 in terms of size, market share 11 years ago, completely different, today from the leaders, in the market. And you could almost analyze each company and trace their trajectory. Industry has grown at 17%, for example, on the top line over the last decade, I said. But, a company like us, Mansard, we have grown at 3 times, that growth rate. We've come from number 97 in 2003 to fourth position, at the end of last year. And it's the same service. Essentially, it's very similar product, but it's a different set of, activities, different set of value proposition, I think, that probably would have made a difference. And if you look at the absolute leaders, some of the companies you mentioned just now, you would also see that they have transformed completely from the way they were 10, 11 years ago. And I think it takes me back to the very first point. It's leadership. It's understanding where you are now and where you really want to be, 10 years down the line.
Leadership, and we're talking in this panel around leadership, business leadership. Our guest speaker will be talking later about governance and leadership in the public space. But let's now transit to current conditions and sources of advantage, competitive advantage. So today we are where we are in all of these sectors we're talking about. It ties into the prior discussion, but today, what do people have to do to succeed in all the different sectors, given where those industries are today? Rashid.
That's across the board, right?
Across the board.
Yeah, I think first is that there's need for audacity. Businesses that have succeeded have been very bold in terms of how they've set their vision. You need to have a vision that some people will probably consider unrealistic, today. But because you believe in that vision, you work seriously towards it, and before you realize it, it's achieved. So audacity is very important. But again, this comes back to the issue of vision, which Tosin mentioned. But I think the other one that's very important is the ability to execute. You see, if you ask everybody in this room, we all know what to do. 100% of people know what to do. The problem is always actually doing it. And that's why execution is very important. Being able to roll up your sleeves and actually move everybody in the organization towards, attainment of that vision, that audacious goal that you've set for the business. Now, but it's easier said than done, because what by execution it means that we need to look at all the elements of the business and get them moving concurrently at the same time. All the departments, Tosin said value chain, all the value chain, everything has to move. It's almost like the conductor of an orchestra. There are different instruments
playing, you know, different tones, moving in different directions, but everything is playing towards a particular music. The music has to rhyme at the end of the day. So I think those are maybe I should pause for.
Let me ask Rashid a follow-on. Because from my experience in the Nigerian business space, the dysfunctionality around execution is actually a problem often of corporate culture and people. So do you have any comments or any reflections on that?
I agree with you that culture plays a role. People is very important. But I think the most important factor in execution is leadership. Because the leader has to set the example. Okay, so if we have several things to do, and we have teams that have been set up, you know, how are you structuring that team? How are you resourcing the teams? How are you driving them? How are you holding them accountable? How are you measuring their performance? So there are a lot of management activities, you know, that all ultimately lead to executing the goals and objectives.
Okay, so what do you think? Agriculture, which is almost like new, what do you have to do to win going forward?
Sure, and I'll speak from the perspective of an investor in that sector. And as we assess companies we want to invest in, and I agree completely that execution is key. And the question then is, how do you, as an investor, assess a company or a team's ability to execute within that space? Because there are many great ideas, many great business plans, many companies that seem good on the surface, but where are they going to be 5 years from now beyond what the surface you see? And I think for us, one thing that we need to see is passion from the management team. We need to generally see them excited, passionate about the space they're in. This is what they breathe, dream, wake up in the morning thinking about. That passion has to come out in the interaction. We also need to see a desire and willingness to stay very close to the business. Now, this is especially critical in our space because you have a situation where capital is in Lagos and in urban centers, and the businesses are out in the smaller towns and cities. So if you're a managing director of an agribusiness company sitting in Lagos, it's not going to happen. You have to be close to the business wherever that business is. If your business is in Awka, if your business is in Ishin, wherever your business is, if your business is in Gombe, you have to make sure that you're there, the entrepreneur is there actually monitoring and watching the business to minimize leakages, help build the team, help extract value. Then also, in the tower of the execution, beyond driving the businesses, also looking at different line items from top line is straightforward, but also the expense side. How is the team viewing that expense profile? So for us, we've come across companies that are involved in, I won't mention the sector, and building the business, but yet the entrepreneur is staying in nice fancy hotels outside of that on trips. So there's a mismatch between executing, building the business with taking into account the realities of the company itself and lifestyle. So you need a team that understands the business, passionate, and staying very close to business to drive it. But execution is very key to do that.
Thank you very much. Tosin, what do we have to do to win? And I'd like you to take the different elements, health insurance, which is very new, and the core insurance sector itself. Without having to teach your competitors how to beat you?
Well, I think generally, whether you know you were talking about co-insurance, health insurance, asset management, pension, I think the key elements are to get leadership, and the leadership must then drive, you know, must then get the right people and create the right culture. I think with those three elements, you will then chase all the other factors and ensure the other factors move, you know, in tandem, you know, with the vision that the leadership has. People are central to everything. And in one firm, you can have a group of, you know, first-class graduates, you know, excellent brains, and that company might not move forward at the right kind of speed. And in the other organization, you can have very regular Joes, lots of, you know, tutus, a few third classes, etc., etc. And with the right culture, with the right training, with the right motivation, you know, the other company excels. And you ask, you know, what's really responsible? I think it's an interplay of everything put together. But I would put, you know, the central, you know, focus would be on creating this enabling environment, this culture, you know, for the people. I remember once one of the pioneers in the last generation of banks that were developed in the early 90s was asked a question. He said, you know, how come you built such a great, you know, bank? And he said, you know, his own role is to find people that are smarter than him, you know, give them the right training and the right environment, and then get out of their way so that they can build, you know, this organization. And, you know, the organization today is a great, you know, organization. I think really it boils down to that. Understanding where health insurance needs to go. Today, health insurance, you know, has maybe about 6 million lives. We're told we are 170 million people. My chairman says we are, you know, a lot less than that. But whether it's 120, whether it's 170 million people, you know, we're quite a number. And 6 million is very, very far. How are we going to transit from 6 million to actually having 100 million lives? What are the things that need to be done? Who is going to do it? What are all of the factors? I think leadership will begin to examine today, you know, what the environment needs to look like, what the factors need to look like, and ensure that, you know, we begin to put this in place. And this will cut across, you know, all of the sectors. If we take a look at pension took off only 11 years ago. About 20 licenses were given out. But one company today has close to 40% market share. How? Why? Because from day one, I think the leadership understood, you know, what needed to be done, understood the value chain, understood the sort of structure they needed to put in place, understood the sort of people they needed to put in place, understood the right culture they needed to create, and moved exceedingly fast. You know, whilst the others, you know, thought it was business as usual and they were moving at their pace. And today, an unassailable, you know, leadership in that space, unassailable market share, you know, in that space. And I think that's really, you know, what makes a difference.
Thank you very much, Jose. Okay, this is almost cliche. Technology will determine the winners of tomorrow. But what about technology? What do people have to do? Where? How? Your reflections.
Okay, so in addition to what has been said already, I think innovation is going to play a big role. Because today, the use and adoption of technology is more of a competitive necessity. You know, it's no longer automatically gives you advantage because everybody is doing it. So if I want to get advantage from the adoption of technology, I've got to be doing something different from what everybody is doing. If I want to launch today an online retailer and I'm just following the models that are already out there, I'm not going to get any advantage. So I've got to go back and think about the market, about the need, and about how I can meet that need in a different way, and from the customer's viewpoint, not from my own viewpoint. So innovation is important. I think also mastering your environment, because we are in a challenging operational environment, there's no doubt about it. And therefore we have to understand the environment and we have to master it, because just as there are many challenges, but those challenges themselves can be opportunities, clearly. So an understanding of the environment, an understanding of the opportunities and the risks. Okay, so with technology adoption, as I mentioned earlier, probably one of the greatest risks today is security. So if you don't understand what risk security, you know, poses to you, and you don't address it effectively, then it can lead to business failure. If you're not addressing your business continuity issues, your business can fail very easily, because today the amount of investment that a lot large companies make in technology is significant. You know, it's billions and billions of naira. So innovation, mastering your environment, and then finally I would say collaboration. I think collaboration is going to become increasingly important. I think because of what technology enables, you know, that globalization, you can collaborate with anybody, anywhere in the world, and make it work.
Thank you very much. Great insights. As we begin to round up, let me carry out what was designed to be private conversations with each of our panelists within the bigger conversation. So Rashid, you're CEO of Bank of Industry. And clearly we need to boost industrialization in Nigeria. We need to help SMEs grow. We need to develop that sector of the economy.
What are your thoughts in the bank around how this will happen?
Thanks. So in 2013, the Economic Commission for Africa, ECA, released a report. The title of that report was Making the Most of Africa's Commodities, as a basis for, what they call a commodity-based industrialization. I think about a year after that, Nigeria adopted what is called the Nigeria Industrial Revolution Plan. And the idea is that we have three types of natural resources, almost in abundance in Nigeria. We have oil resources, crude oil. We can add value through, refining the products, through fertilizers, plants, through petrochemical plants and all that. So that's one value chain in the oil industry. The second value chain is the agricultural value chain, which is where Mezu operates. You say, rather than, just plants grow the items and exporting our raw cocoa beans and all that, can we not set up domestic mills and plants to actually add value locally? Why do you want to export cocoa beans? Can you make chocolate in Nigeria? Because if you look at the value chain from cocoa beans to chocolate, the producers of chocolate take 70% of the value. Okay, so which means the farmers get, actually less than 10%. Okay, so that's for the agri value chain. The third one is solid minerals. Okay, as somebody who has been to a number of African countries, most of them actually don't have oil resources. Well, a little bit of agriculture, but there are some countries that depend almost 100% on solid minerals. An example is Zambia. 85% of the foreign exchange earnings of Zambia derives from copper exports. In fact, they have what they call a copper belt, where a lot of the international copper mining companies operate. Now, I have confirmed directly from our federal minister of solid minerals that we have 44 minerals in Nigeria in commercial quantities. That is huge. So what we're trying to do at the Bank of Industry is to align ourselves along these three value chains. So we have a group that is pursuing agro-processing companies, the likes of Mezu's company. We have an oil and gas and petrochemical energy, group. We also have the solid mineral group. So that's how we're aligned to support industrialization in Nigeria.
Stop. Let me ask you a question. Which is, you refer to Zambia, and I know you did a lot of work in UBA across Africa. So that's the second plank of my private conversation with you. How can we? You took UBA to almost 18 countries. How can we leverage Africa? How can Nigerian businesses leverage Africa? Very quickly.
Yeah. So you are talking about regional trade. This was a statistic that we discussed very frequently, while I was at UBA. You find that the amount of trade that happens between African countries, amongst ourselves, compared to the total amount of international trade that we collectively engage in, is less than 10%. Okay, so what that means is that, products go from Ghana to Europe and then come back from Europe to Nigeria. And we tried, within that institution to really change that. We introduced a lot of trade products, that will ensure that, rather than issue an LC, let's say a bank like Barclays Ghana, doing an LC to Barclays Europe, and then Barclays London, advising the LC to Nigeria, can the banks do LCs directly you know, from country A to country B. So in my former bank, which is the bank you are referring to, that happens today. And a lot of customers have now keyed into that. So it's faster and it's actually cheaper for them. We've also introduced, the bank also introduced money transfers, you know. So again, you're able to do more money even for people who want to travel, you know, across from Nigeria to Cameroon, from Nigeria to Kenya, from Nigeria to Senegal, to Cote d'Ivoire, and so on and so forth.
So as a principle, Nigerian businesses should look within the continent.
What you find is that there are people in Burkina Faso who come to Nigeria to buy shea butter. You know, there are people in Gabon who come to Burkina Faso to buy stuff. So a lot of trade is happening, but it's informal. It's not been registered in our formal channels yet. That's why it's not so pronounced.
Let me. Mezo, our conversation is direct. It's about Fafin. Can you share with this audience what this fund, what Fafin does, and how it could add value?
Sure. Fafin stands for the Fund for Agriculture Finance in Nigeria. There are three key sponsors to the fund. KfW Development Bank is a sponsor. It's a development arm of the German government. They've invested $14 million into the fund. The Federal Ministry of Agriculture is also an investor in the fund with a matching amount of 14, and Nigeria Sovereign Wealth Fund is also a sponsored investor in the fund with $10 million. And the focus of the fund is to transform the landscape within the agriculture sector. We make equity and quasi-equity investments, which in many cases complements the loan facilities they may get from the Bank of Industry or other financial institutions. And we take minority stakes in companies that could range from 29% to 49%. These are $500,000 to $5 million investments. Now, beyond just bringing capital, because one of the issues identified is that beyond just having money available for SMEs in the agribusiness spaces, how do you work with these companies to actually scale up? Do they have the capacity to absorb the capital? How can you work with them to grow the businesses over the next 5-10 years? So part of our approach and the way we're structured is very active management from a board level, working with the companies to identify senior people that they can be plugged into different key roles within the firm. And then one key element that we have as well is we have a technical assistance facility, which is effectively grant money that we can use for capacity building. So if you look at many value chains, one of the biggest issues is yield from crop. You have in cassava, the average smaller farmer gets about 12 tons per hectare. The larger scale players maybe get about 22 tons per hectare. But this is quite small when compared in Thailand and Brazil that can get up to 45 tons per hectare. So if your yields are very small, there's no way you can be competitive. In maize in Nigeria, the average farmer is 1-2 tons per hectare, elsewhere up to 8 tons. So with the technical assistance facility, we can actually take some grant money to engage experts, consultants to work with processors to do outgrower schemes. So instead of just bringing capital and saying, here's capital to grow your business, we try and wrap around services to ensure that these companies succeed. And since we're equity, we have no collateral to fall back on if it doesn't go well. So we need to make sure we understand the businesses and where they're very actively building those enterprises. And given the nature of our business as well, we invest effectively everywhere outside of Lagos. Because by the nature of the business, it is not an urban-based business, but more in the smaller towns and the cities.
Excellent. Thanks. Tosin, let me not only focus your intervention at this point on the outlook and prospects for health insurance, given the critical nature of health, and the fact that, like you said, government cannot do the job. So what do you see as the outlook for that sector in Nigeria?
Opeyemi, the second largest insurance group in the world is a US-based health insurance company. It's second only to our parent company, AXA. AXA is the biggest insurance company in the world. And that tells you how health insurance has evolved, you know, in places where health provision is not the sole preserve of the government. In the social welfare states of Europe, you would see the government heavily involved, you know, and you know, citizens just use, you know, the health facilities. But I think in most of the parts of the world as we go on, certainly in Nigeria, the government cannot provide, you know, for help. And what we have seen is we have seen two laws that have evolved over the last 10 to 15 years. I think one was done just last year, that are beginning to shape the future. The first law essentially makes it compulsory for the federal government of Nigeria to insure all their staff along with their dependents. And the second law, you know, states expressly how much money the government needs to put aside, you know, to finance, you know, help. The third one that is coming is going to be similar in some ways to the Pension Reform Act. It's going to make health insurance compulsory for every organization that has a minimum number of employees. It could be 5, it could be 10. And what this means is that as we move along, we are going to rapidly increase the number of people that are going to be enrolled in the, with health insurance programs. But there are a number of things that we need to look at. I said earlier that we need to look at the providers, for example, because it's a value chain. The employer or the individual buys health insurance, you know, policy through a health insurance company, and the health insurance company has a contract with the providers. The providers provide the services. What we are seeing is a likely situation where we will have more and more companies, health insurance companies, having integrated systems, whereby they are either investors in or they themselves, you know, invest in and develop, you know, world-class medical centers, hospitals that can really, you know, provide the services for Nigeria as we grow. We're seeing more and more people today who, once they have anything more than headache or malaria, they get on the plane, you know, and they're off. They're off to different places. Some to South Africa, some to Dubai, you know, some to the UK, some to America, as expensive as it is. But once you have more than, you know, your people are off. But the truth is, with health insurance and with the pooling of funds from a large number of people, we can see the opportunities that are evolving. And with the integrated system, I believe strongly that within a 5 to 7 year period, we will see world-class hospitals set up here in Nigeria. We will see health insurance companies that are working, you know, with these hospitals to ensure that people pay as little as possible but have access to the best possible care across the world. And this is already beginning. We know one or two companies that have already evolved this system, but the rate of evolution in the health space, I think, will be much faster than many people can see today.
We take our final comments, reflecting on the future of all our sectors over the next 5, 10, 15 years. What do you see? And what should we be preparing for? And I'll just write down.
Okay, so I see the increasing adoption of technology at increased pace. I see Nigerians being very resilient and always wanting to be right ahead, really, really adopting technology. I see payments, e-payments growing at rapid paces. I see Nigeria sort of leading the rest of the continent in that respect, in terms of, you know, this whole dream of whether it's one, a unified payment system, not necessarily one currency, but I see the whole sector, you know, sub-Saharan Africa, being clearly interconnected and therefore unleashing a myriad of possibilities about what is possible for organizations to do. And because of the sheer numbers of people in Africa, I see that actually having an impact on the world as a whole. The proviso for me is, if we take seriously, obviously, those issues around governance, risk and compliance, if not, we will have a lot of false starts and we'll find ourselves, you know, one step forward and many steps backwards. So I see technology playing an increasingly pervasive role in the economy of the country and in the economy of the continent. I see a situation where hopefully, very rapidly, the skills challenge will be closed, because there is that skills challenge, which is a key inhibitor. The other challenges around technology adoption, which are infrastructural, clearly have to be addressed. So in the next 5-10 years, we're hoping that, you know, things like power, infrastructure are no longer inhibitors, but they're enablers, you know. And so really, I really see that organizations who take an effective approach to the adoption of technology cannot win. But as I said, tying it closely to your business proposition, you know, how does it add value? And I also see a situation where, because there is a transition of generations, because there is also a generational challenge, you know, the older people who may not really understand technology and whom technology is mystified will begin to step aside. And you begin to have people who were born and who grew up on technology, and that really, I mean, if you see young people and the way they use technology, it's amazing. So I expect to see a fundamentally transformational impact from technology.
Tosin,
your views around insurance?
So I'll talk about two sectors, the life and general insurance as well as pension. For the insurance sector, today it's still fairly fragmented. We have 57 players, with the largest company having 14%. I think 10 years down the line, it will be far less fragmented. Maybe we will have 15 to 20 players, but they will be a lot bigger, they will be a lot stronger, and the top five will probably have market share of about 60%. So it will be a much more consolidated, you know, sector. I think sooner or later, we will have a regulator who will probably do, you know, the right thing and essentially just, you know, wield the big stick and remove, you know, a lot of the stragglers. But how will we evolve from here, you know, to that point? I think there will be a lot of diversification of distribution channels, and I think the technology will drive the electronic channels significantly. The younger generation that is evolving, who cannot remember anything about insurance because their parents, you know, didn't buy insurance when they were growing up, they will have to learn about insurance afresh, but they will learn it from a very different perspective. It will be sold via their social media, you know, etc., and they will buy it and consume it in a very different way from the way that many of us in this room, you know, have bought insurance, you know, over time. And then for those companies that will be there, you know, at that time, you know, who will be, you know, leaders in the market, I believe will be companies who evolve very clearly. Strategies that will leverage on technology and the evolving environment to sell, you know, insurance products. With pension, I think the pension industry is going to get so much bigger than where they are today, and the level of regulation will become, it's already fantastic, but it will become a lot more stringent because these organizations will own all of us. They will own controlling shares in every quoted entity. I suspect by that time they would have allowed them to also go into unquoted, you know, equity, and we will all, you know, one way or the other, work for them. Yes. But they will be much bigger, they will be a lot more regulated, and they would also have a bigger role to play in developing infrastructure, you know, within our environment. And therefore, they would almost look like government, you know, organizations in terms of their relevance. I think these are the changes that I see, you know, in these two sectors going forward.
Thank you very much. Let me allow that to focus on the Bank of Industry and Industrialization. Or you may go beyond that.
Yeah, because, you know, as a development bank, we are right at the center of the economy. So let me just project generally, you know, for the Nigerian economy. And I see a few sectors emerge. I think the creative industry is going to get much, much bigger than it is today. And the signs, the early signs are very, very impressive. We're going to see a lot of production, you know, high budget production, you know, taking place, multi-million dollar, you know, films, you know, being produced in Nigeria. We are working very actively at this moment with most of the major players in that sector, either in terms of actual production of movies or actually setting up international quality movie studios in Nigeria, and also being able to distribute the movies either physically through cinemas, some of which were financed, and also through online platforms, you know, to ensure that there is a protection of rights, you know, the owner's rights. So that's one area that I think will emerge. The other one is what I call off-grid solar energy. Adoption is going to become more rapid. For some reasons, which you know we all know, the utilities haven't quite risen up to the challenge. So I think a lot more homes, especially in the rural communities, are going to go for what I call prepaid off-grid solar energy solutions. We have seen this happen in some parts of Africa. There's a company called M-Copper that has deployed solar energy solutions to over 500,000 homes in Kenya and Uganda. And it's very simple, you know, it's deployed. The payments, you know, for that solution is very retail, and it works on the basis of prepaid technology, you know, similar to what really drove up the growth in the telecom sector. So you pay very little sums, maybe 50 city naira, you know, per day, and if you don't pay, the light goes off, and the controllers, you know, payment controllers that are attached to each home that that controls what happens. So that's one sector that I think we're going to see a very rapid adoption, you know, of such a solution. Again, the Bank of Industry, we are working with the United Nations Development Program on this. I think more information will be made public in the weeks ahead. I also think that although we've been we've done fairly well in terms of adoption of technology as a country, but we have done very poorly in terms of development of technology. I must say that that is an area that gives me sleepless nights, you know, as a CEO in a development bank. I have engaged with most of our leading research institutes in Nigeria. I've engaged with the likes of FIRO, Federal Institute of Industrial Research in Oshodi. I have engaged with Project Development Institute in Enugu. I've been to Naseni, Nigeria Engineering Institute in Abuja. And I've been to even NOTA, the agency that registers payments for technologies in Nigeria. What we do is we bring a lot of foreign technologies to Nigeria, and we are constantly remitting, you know, payments to the owners of the technology. We are very slow in developing our own technology. I know there has been some activity in the ICT area in terms of, you know, writing apps and programs. It's very good, but I think the real innovation is in terms of atoms, not bits and bytes. And that's an area that gives me worry.
Thank you very much. Great insights from Rashid, and hope all these things you are working on bear fruit. Mezo, final thoughts?
There are two trends which bode very well for agriculture in Nigeria. One trend is globally, their food prices are increasing, and there's also diminishing land available for agriculture around the world, which means that groups either have to be more efficient or go to alternate geographies for agribusiness. The second is that Nigeria has a very large consumer population and a very large growing middle class. Nigeria's middle class is bigger than Ghana's entire population. There's an expectation that another 70 billion people will be added to the population over the next 10 years, and Nigeria's population forecast to be about 450 million by 2050. Now, this feeds into opportunities for investors that will drive transformation. On the consumer population side, you have retailers moving to the market who need to build local supply chain. You pick ShopRite. ShopRite has been steadily increasing the number of local suppliers of products to their stores and across a broad range. And many SMEs are actually doubling and tripling their businesses just from distributing through ShopRite. You take fruits and vegetables. Over the past 3 years, there are over 10 greenhouses, large-scale greenhouses that have been put together, developed to supply various fruits and vegetables to ShopRite. Look at dairy, the same thing, aggressive build out of various dairy products by local businesses within the country. Meat products, eggs, there's a pull into the local supply chain to meet that demand. If you look at the QSR space, either with international players looking at the sector, expanding operations, see, I believe there's a recent transaction with one of the large fast food companies with a foreign investor coming in. For those players, they also need to build out their local supply, chicken, spices, the various ingredients that go, which feeds into the to local suppliers. Looking long term, how does this transform the sector? Right now, with the fruits and vegetables, tomatoes, 45-50% spoil on the farm gate. Another 10% spoils because they're transported in baskets on top of trailers to mile 12. Now, as investors and big players come in to address the gap and the need, it means that there's a build out of a cold room supply chain. That cold room supply chain then transports dairy, it transports meats, it transports veg. You look at maize. Right now there's a shortage of maize in the country, so some is imported periodically. And so the average storage we have around the country is warehouse space. Warehouse space is not adequate for long-term storage. There are a handful of players that actually have proper silos that can store product for 4 or 5 years. So as we build then the capacity within the agricultural space, you then see more and more silos being built up, not only for own use, but also for third-party use. This also feeds into logistics, because with the products being developed in different areas, there's better, more efficient logistics that's pushed around the country. You then have larger players that realize that they need to build capacity here in Nigeria to meet the market demand. It means companies like Unilever, like Nestle, like Nigerian Breweries, amongst others, are figuring out which of their raw materials can they source locally at a very competitive price point to meet the demand in this market. And when you then look, project over the next 10, 15 years, you realize that within this space, for those that are well positioned, it's a completely different opportunity, a different space from where it is today.
Great stuff. Encouraging insights from my panel. Tosin says health insurance, pension funds, and even the general insurance is going to bloom. Do you want to talk about risk and governance and compliance and managing the risks? Rashid told us a lot of exciting things around solar energy and all of those things. And of course, I knew that Mezo has fantastic insights into agri finance and the development of agricultural sector. Please give a round of applause to that panel. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Mezo, Rashid, Tosin, and Doyin. It's been a fantastic discussion. The key words that came out for me, which suggests my reflections on any discussion, is usually to focus on what the keywords were. And we had leadership, we had technology, we had innovation, we had risks, we had growth, we had execution. And I guess that if you reflect on all of those words, you probably would be doing the right things in your own businesses. Thank you very much, panelists, and thank you very much, the audience.
We have actually tried to be efficient with time, so we refer you to pages 6 and 7 of the brochure for the first book review. And to present the first book is the first book titled Uncomplex Strategy, Making Business Strategy Accessible to Managers, Entrepreneurs, and Students. Please join me as I welcome the Group Managing Director and CEO, UACN PLC, Mr. Larry Eitan.
A birthday boy, or rather birthday man. Our distinguished panelists who we had the pleasure of just listening to, and also distinguished guest lecturer. First of all, let me congratulate the author, Mr. Opeyemi Agbaje, at turning 210. And very characteristic of his intellectual seriousness, instead of inviting me to an elaborate Owambe, a usual spectacle in Lagos, has asked that I show up on a Thursday before Easter to do a book's presentation on a serious matter as strategy. I'm happy, at least the title of the book does suggest a more relaxed approach to strategy. Perhaps I should also mention that I'll be disappointing you by confessing that I have not read the book. But it was some comfort I stand here because I've had the benefit of reading the man who wrote the book. I have enjoyed the privilege of working on business advisory with Opeyemi, whose company, RTC Advisory Services Limited, UACN of Nigeria, has retained for the past 8 years under my watch. In my life work as a chief executive officer, I've come to realize that strategy itself isn't complex. What is complex is the thought or thinking about strategy. Therefore, strategy should be and must aim for businesses to become simple, easy, focused, with fewer papers to read and problems to solve, so that everyone in management team becomes slightly more relaxed. Life already is very difficult. Nothing successful is complex. On complex strategy would actually be easier to communicate. The more deeply you understand something, the more willing you are to take risk, and the more intelligent are those risks. Opeyemi is someone with fearsome intelligence. And however, I must say that he's not too secure in his own insight to become unimpressed or unappreciative of the wisdom of others. He has the intellectual temperament, which does not allow him to have overconfident thinking, something which I think is in short supply among a lot of us in business. I do have concerns, however, about two areas of his judgment. One being his football. His allegiance to Chelsea, a team renowned for its inelegant play, but somewhat successful in terms of results, perhaps a clear manifestation of the Uncomplex strategy. Second, being a celebrated columnist on economy, polity, and society in Business Day newspaper, I find his thoughts on federal politics quite complex. While some of us choose to hold Uncomplex strategy views about our nation as validated in the ballot count of May 28 presidential elections. Opeyemi is someone you may disagree with his choices, but never with his motive. Well, in life, having turned 50 earlier than him, increasingly I've come to realize that reasonable minds can sometimes disagree. Business strategy is one area both of us find a happy balance. So, happy 50th birthday, Opeyemi. So I would quickly then move to the pleasant task of presenting the book written by the man we know on complex strategy. So I urge you all, be you students, those in academia, be you in business, be you in politics. When I say business, it could be pastors in churches. Because I saw that this book is for entrepreneurs. And some of the biggest entrepreneurs are actually called pastorpreneurs. So I urge you to buy, and you don't just buy, I also urge you to read it. My pleasure. On comments, on complex.
Again, being efficient with time, we refer you to pages 8 and 9 of the brochure for the second book review. Please welcome Professor Juan, who will present the second book titled Democracy Without Democrats, Travel of Politics and Development in Nigeria, 1999 to 2011.
Thank you. Well, thank you very much. I can see many known faces here. I mean, I think that the way of Opeyemi, the trajectory he has followed, you can see the different geological layers represented here in this room. Now, my job is not to review the book, but to present it. Thank God it's a very different thing. I have to be careful because being a non-Nigerian, he can afford talking about democracy without Democrats. I will just stick to democracy. No, but at the same time, as usually happens with Opeyemi, I think he has been uncommonly lucky, because clearly this book is being presented at a moment that is very special, I think, in the evolution of Nigerian democracy. It's not only that many people in Nigeria are excited about what has happened in the last days, and I think clearly has been a very important step forward. I have heard many people commenting to me. We have seen also even what happened in the stock exchange. I think can only be described as a collective sigh of relief. I mean, and I can tell you, probably many of you will have had the experience, I have been amazed how many friends from abroad had also written to me, sent emails, how many people are very, very excited about what has happened in Nigeria. So, at this moment, I can say, knowing what, being a regular reader column of Opeyemi Business Day, guessing therefore about much of the contents of this book, putting it together with what has happened, and so it's going to be a very exciting book to read. I have had the opportunity of seeing it briefly outside. At the same time, I certainly can say it's a beautifully produced book. So certainly it's a book that all of us should have. And I think, I get a bit frustrated being an academic. I very often see people buying books. And people buy the book and go straight to the bookcase, very often not to be taken from there. And for many of us have read Opeyemi Business Day, is the place where he is the most accessible. It's very much worth reading. I'm sure it will be an enriching experience. Let me take advantage and claim a bit of paternal authority on the book, because Opeyemi himself confesses that much of these two books were written during his stay in LBS. So I think that therefore we are to be congratulated for the fact that although it has taken time for him to bring them out. So I think now I would like to...
Do you want to add anything before we uncover the books? Okay, so please, I here have the pleasure to present to you Democracy, etc. from Opeyemi Agbaje.
And now to the highlight of the program, a lecture titled Democracy and Governance in Nigeria. This lecture will be delivered by our keynote speaker, Mr. Joseph Olujimi Kolawole Agbaje, is a pharmacist by training from the then University of Ife, now Obafemi Awolowo University, Ife. He possesses over 3 decades experience as a practicing pharmacist and founded JK Pharmaceutical and Chemical Company Limited, which is responsible for the manufacturing and distribution of pharmaceuticals across the country. He's a fellow Pharmaceutical Society of Nigeria, fellow West African Postgraduate College of Pharmacists, Merit Award winner, Pharmaceutical Society of Nigeria, Lagos State. Mr. Agbaje has participated in various international programs, including the Executive Management Program at the Wits Business School, Johannesburg, and Cape Town Business School, South Africa. World Health Organization training courses on good manufacturing practice in the pharmaceutical sector, UNICEF Oral Radiation Therapy Program, Train the Trainer Course. He sits on board of Video Holdings, Oakwood Park Limited, and Atlantic Hall Secondary School, Ekwe. On his political career, his affiliation and leadership positions in Afenifere made him join the Alliance for Democracy, his first political party. In 2007, Agbaje, who had initially aspired to contest for the governorship of Lagos State on the platform of the Action Congress, a successor to Alliance for Democracy, left the party to join the Democratic People's Alliance, DPA. While they believed to have conducted the best campaign in 2007, he lost to Babatunde Rajifashola of the Action Congress. Currently, he is the candidate of the People's Democratic Party for the 2015 Lagos gubernatorial election, holding a couple of days from now. Mr. Agbaje is widely respected as a professional in politics, a honorable and decent individual, a businessman and a leader. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mr. Oluyemi Agbaje.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm not sure if I qualify yet to be a Democrat, just taking the cue from Opeyemi's book, Democracy Without Democrats. I think that's a shot at all of us in politics. But with time, I think we begin to see Democrats. I'm especially pleased to have been invited to deliver the keynote address for today's occasion, outside the visibility that this represents within the context of ongoing developments in the country. Three strong reasons recommend this occasion. First is to join others in celebrating Opeyemi on his golden jubilee. Many ask if we are related. This provides a fine opportunity to publicly disown the man. We do not share a drop of blood. I believe Opeyemi is from Sagamu, while I am a Lagos boy. We have, however, both benefited from the strong brand the Agbaje name has established with other Agbajes. Many happy returns of your golden jubilee, Opeyemi. Many more years of good health, happiness, prosperity, and positive contribution to our country. The second reason is my persuasion on the need for more of our nationals to commit thought to print as part of the discussion, without which we may not be able to design proper responses to the real issues that we contend with. The printed word, in my view, represents one of the more important treasuries available to mankind. Words and the ideas that they lend expression to are the quintessential vaults beyond which moth and rust cannot reach. They are thus the likeliest place for a people concerned with the verdict of history to store all that they value. Unfortunately, we rarely have recourse to this depot of values in these parts. Thirdly, at the important juncture that our country is at today, no two words, democracy and governance, can properly capture the spirit of the age these two words do. It stirs with great pleasure, it is a great pleasure to have been invited to talk about these. Now, I look at the audience and I wonder whether my speech will fit into this audience. So, I have here talk on democracy and governance that is more rooted in those who are very much into political history and all. And I see the suits and ties here, and I wonder whether I will not send you to sleep. So you'll allow me to speak off the coffee the way I believe you will appreciate better. We're talking of governance. We're talking of democracy. Democracy, what, government of the people, by the people, for the people. And we want things to work. It's important that we understand how it all starts and read the experience. I'm writing it, and I can tell you why it works and why it doesn't work. There's no way you see the end product. When I say the end product, you see the candidates when they emerge, but you don't see the process, because democracy is not at the point of voting. Democracy is rooted in the whole process from the beginning, from when you form the political party. So who are those that form the political party? What are their goals? What are their values? Why have they formed the party? Is it for good governance? Or is it to corner a share of the cake? Now, these are issues that come up. Now, so once that is wrong, then of course, there's no way you're going to relate that to good governance. But as it works, some people start with the wrong motives, and some others take over from them. But somebody has to govern for as long as you're running a civilian dispensation. So it's like a race. You know, each time, what has happened in the past is the military hands over. We start the experiment, and we go 4 years, 8 years, and once it doesn't go some way, your way, you say, let's crash it. Because you see, you cannot get a hold on things. Let's crash it. And it's crashed, it goes back to the military, they run it, and then you go back again. Then you build it again. Now, if you win, you try and hold on to it. If you don't win, then you're looking off as to how to crash it again. And that's what's been happening in our country. And that's why we must give ourselves some credit that at least this time round, we've done 16 years, and we're likely at least to do another 4 years, making it 20. Because it's the first time that it's getting difficult to crash, or better still, there's more will to make it run rather than crash it. But then we must accept that in bringing it together, the motives may not have been so much for governance, for good governance. But with time, we will see how it evolves. So I first talk about forming the political party. Now, it's different when you now form the political party, maybe with good intentions. Then you want to put people in positions in the political party. And that means you need the chairman, you need the executive members of the party. Now, who chooses these people? Is it the few that are powerful, have the money, the resources, and are able to install, so to say, their own people there? So if you talk about democracy, which is about numbers, about people voting for who they want to lead, then you've already crashed democracy at that point. So it means you choose a chairman of the party who is probably in the pocket of those that have put him in place. He's not there about democracy. He's there to serve the purpose of the person or persons that have put him there. And so already your democracy begins to shake. So that's an issue. Then, of course, you go on and the elections are coming, and you want to choose candidates. Let's talk about first start from the low level, the local government. You then decide that you want to have people that are going to represent the party at the local government. Now, if you're already in power, you can decide that I want to hold power and I want to hold this grassroots as a person or as persons. And so you say, the best way I can have power in Ikoyi local government, let me use Ikoyi since we're in Ikoyi, is if I bring an Ikoyi person here. There are things he may not be able to do because he's from this area. He's probably grown up here. He's enjoying, say, the parks. And I want to build a house where that park is. Now, if I bring an Ikoyi person here, he's going to find it difficult to allow me to build that park because it's where he grew up. So I can then say, you know what, I'm not going to bring an Ikoyi person here. I'm going to bring somebody from Agege and install him in Ikoyi. Now there are two things that happen. The first one is that person is not liked in Ikoyi because he didn't grow up in Ikoyi. He's not the choice of the membership in Ikoyi. So his only allegiance is to the person that has put him there. So if that person or persons decide that they want to build the house where the park is, he really couldn't care less. Because in any case, if he doesn't agree, then he's out of the job. So when you're talking about governance, you know, I'm trying to relate both now, and saying that once that is faulty, then it's going to affect governance. And so I think Rashid and Cole spoke about institutions and things like that. You need to build the party itself or the politics as an institution, or else you are not going to have or guarantee good governance. He talked about it growing beyond the CEO. Presently, our governance is still dependent on the CEO, in this case, those that own the political party. So if the party, if the owners are good, then there will be good governance. But if they are bad, then there will be bad governance. So again, you look at that and you say, fine, I've used local government as an example. I brought in somebody and I know that his allegiance is to me and to nobody else. Then you go up and you want to choose House of Rep, House of Senate and all. And then again, is who is going to listen to me? Because that's the consideration in many cases where you're not running democracy the way it should be. So no matter how good you may be, for as long as it doesn't suit the purpose of the person or persons that holds the party, then there's a problem. Unfortunately, in our own case, the military did something in bringing about democracy at some point in time, where they talked about a new breed of politicians. Politics before, you had a situation where as a party member, you all contributed to the party. You were, you know, like you pay membership dues for clubs. That no longer happens. So it is people that contribute to you now in the party. And that means you can't claim ownership of the party. Unlike the First Republic, where you still have members who show you their membership cards, showing the dues they have paid as members. But when you're a member, then you have a right to talk, you have a right to complain. But where that isn't happening, you really don't have any right because it's really not your party. It is the person that is funding the party or the persons that own the party. And that's why it's easy to say, what are you talking about? I want this person to be your chairman. And who are you to say he cannot be chairman? Now, so democracy is affected. And then it goes up, you know, you can go up the ladder to Senate, to governor, even to president. And I'm sure you're all familiar with how our presidents have emerged also. So that's one aspect of it. There's the other aspect of how do you fund the political party? Because again, it affects governance. You want to run for office, be it councillor, be it chairman, you've got to spend money. And in most cases, it's money you don't have at every level. And if you want to be a councillor, you probably have seen a very young person probably just managing to, you know, make ends meet. But you want to be a councillor, you still got to spend money, and you don't have the money. So what do you do? Do you go to a big man and ask him to fund you? At what price is the funding coming from? In Nigeria today, you have people who actually invest in funding people in some parts of the country, where they're saying, yes, you want to run for governor, you want to run for this, it's going to cost X billion. I'm going to put the money down, but these are going to be my returns on investment. So that kind of a democracy is not likely to bring about good governance. I'm throwing this up because like I said, I see gurus, financial gurus, management gurus and all. So it's how this kind of system can be broken if we want to have institutionalized process of bringing about good governance that is not necessarily dependent on the CEO, I think as Rashid said. So you go back and say, how do you fund? Because it's very expensive. The system, the presidential system, is a very expensive system. And so you've got to find the money. And there are people ready to give you that money, but it is at a very heavy price. And so where you're balancing yourself and saying, yeah, but I'm about good governance. Okay, sit down and be waiting for good governance. You have X billion to run this your project. You are talking good governance. Get there first, then you can be talking good governance. And that's what you get. There's another industry that I found out now happens in the business where people are raising, you know, asking, I'm telling you, no, we can raise money for you. And I'm like, okay. Yeah, but you see, our cut is 30%, 30%. It's a whole new business. And I'm talking serious. And I'm talking serious money. That the people that are saying, you know, we can raise you ₦1 billion. But our cut is 20%, is 30%. So they make 300, 200 million. That's enough for them to survive for another 4 years, you know. But the person who's giving you the 1 billion is going to ask you for something. Because as far as he's concerned, or she's concerned, I've given you ₦1 billion. So, it's not a system that can be guaranteed to bring about good governance. The process or the way it's being done does not guarantee good governance. So, where you are conscious of these facts, then you've got to tread very carefully. Or else you will get into office, all right, but you will not be able to bring about good governance. So these are some of the issues. I think I'll just write in some notes, like I said, when I saw the audience and I said, no, I can't, I have to change what I want to say. So that's that. And so we're going to ask ourselves, if we want to guarantee good governance, what can we do to change this? I don't know what Opeyemi has got in his book. So when it was only here I saw the topic, in fact, democracy without democrats. And I said, well, that must be directed at us all. Some of us still claim that we're Democrats, at least for now. But it's important. If you want to be a Democrat in its real sense, it means that you want to choose the person who's going to handle elections in your state and believe that the person is going to be an impartial judge rather than choose somebody who you know is going to take your own bidding. Now, that is a difficult call. Today, President Jonathan is being accused by a lot of his own people. Hey, you made Jega INEC chairman. You see now? Jega came in with credentials of being an impartial umpire. He was chosen because of that. In other words, at that time, the president wanted to show the world that he wanted INEC to be independent. Well, but you go down to the states, for example, and see those that they put in charge of their own state electoral commissions. The people who don't say anything against the government. So it means, where is democracy coming from? Can it ever be? So you run elections at the state level, for example, you win, and the state commissioner says you have lost. And your best bet is to go to court. Now, when you do go to court, you are going to the court by the state. Now, the person in the state has decided that, you know, again, like I said, I'm speaking generally, I'm not talking about any state in particular, so please, I'm not here campaigning, don't, I know I'm running a thin line, but the person who owns the state, or who is in charge of the state, who is governor, whatever, has already taken care of the judges in different ways, has given them free houses, has given them this. So you go to court, and you say, they beat me, they cheated me at the tribunal. And the judge looks at you and says, you see. So except you've got a very, very, very tight case. And you know, these things are not very tight. You don't really win. You can't prove that you have been rigged out very easily. So it's always on the side of the piper. And that affects democracy. Because it means that in many cases, you can't even fight your cause. It means that what happens today is that people say, it doesn't matter how you win, you just win and sit, because it's going to be difficult to remove you. You know, so you're ready to do anything, knowing that to remove you will be very difficult, even when you do know that you were not the winner. Now, these are some of the things that affect our democracy, or, you know, that translate to good governance. And so, you probably ask me, what's the way forward? And I say, fine, the way forward is we've got to look at some of these things. We've got to be more interested. Again, I'm talking to this crowd. Last elections, this last Saturday, we got calls from you. They are cheating here. Oh, they haven't come. Oh, I don't see the agent. You know, and I'm like, can't you be an agent? It's your area. If you really believe in that process, why can't you be an agent in that place? But no, it's not for me. It's for others. But you know, those others, they don't have the standing that you have. They don't even understand the rules, the guidelines that are used to conduct those elections. So the INEC man who has taken money from one side or the other says no. And those people cannot argue. But if you are the one there, you say, what do you mean? Because common sense will tell you that I'm an agent, you can't tell me this. Then you'll be helping democracy. So what I'm saying is, we're too much aloof in bringing about good governance, or in institutionalizing democracy in a way that it guarantees good governance over a period of time. We need to do a lot more. We need to get more involved at different levels. We need to get much more involved in even looking at what plays out in terms of management, in terms of consultancy, free consultancy to INEC, free consultancy to the parties, free consultancy to the candidates. You know, some were talking to me 2 days ago. They rigged us. I said, how did they rig you? That we didn't even know when they put the ballot paper there. I said, okay, you're a polling agent. The guideline says before they take anything out of the center of where the things are packed, you're supposed to be there with the INEC people and leave with them to your polling unit. He said, but they didn't allow me in. They didn't allow him in, or because he's a small man. He doesn't know his rights. So what you should be doing is to look for people who know their rights. Like, hey, come on, I'm a polling agent. I need to know. You had cases where they say, oh, there's no ballot paper for the president, or there's no ballot paper for the House of Rep. The polling agent is supposed to ensure, before leaving the center where they're collecting the material, can I see everything you've got? Have you got the president's own? Have you got the House of Rep? Have you got the result sheets? You saw Amici on TV shouting that there was no result sheet. Because it's very clear what can happen. If you don't have a result sheet and you have the votes, the only thing you can write the results on is on the sheet of paper. The only thing the court is going to look at is the result sheet. So even if you score 100% on that piece of paper, it's useless. Now, these are some of the issues that come into play, because we have to understand why politicians, you know, play all those games and all. And that's important. Again, of course, you can talk about, as a Democrat, how much space do you allow others to speak, to express themselves? It's supposed to be about ideas. So, you put up your poster and it's like, don't let the poster stay. How much of a Democrat are you? Such things affect the process, because it means that you see somebody that apparently is good or better, and you just refuse to allow him or her to see, to for the public to appreciate. He may have 10 posters only, but allow the 10 posters to stay. So democracy, and that's why the presenter was very clever by not saying the others, expressing that, you know, I'm not in Nigeria, you know. So these are some of the things that we begin to ask ourselves. And we must begin to question, to query, and come out and speak properly that why, what is your problem? Again, you got the negatives, again coming in, this is from the American system. And America, even for America, it's a recent thing, this negative publicity or negative campaigning. I don't think it's something we should encourage. We want to hear, what do you have for us? Not to abuse, you know. Yeah, it's a free world, you can do what you like, but I'm not sure that it's something we should encourage, seriously. So if we want to do get a democracy going, these are some of the things that I think we need to look at. Like I said, I will give Opeyemi the paper for whatever it's worth. So I'm saying, in terms of the way forward, I just put something here, I say, I imagine, therefore, two ways to strengthen our democracy and its governance. First is that we agree on the design of a much smaller state. I think this refers more to, this will appeal more to you. We agree on the design of a much smaller state and proceed to implement it over the next years. Not much of this argument is new. Indeed, I would hold that we are already in some of general agreement over its broad description. This essentially involves transferring a number of our state-owned enterprises to the private sector. In other words, we find that, I mean, there's so many agencies that are out there are not giving us value, not even giving us good governance. We're having agencies, regulatory agencies that have more become terrorist agencies, that have become revenue generating agencies rather than regulatory, you know, such things. We have to strengthen the public sector as regulator of a vibrant private sector where barriers to entry, doing business and exit are a lot lower than at present. And implementing the principle of subsidiarity, that is moving responsibility for governance down to the smallest and lowest or least centralized authority, competent to deal with the issues involved. The second plan in my reform, and I use this word most advisedly, platform, is that based on the need to reinforce social infrastructure. Without the right kind of social capital, we are doomed. And educated people would choose better leaders, would drive innovative practices, would work smarter, and are likely to obey rules more. Again, what I would say on this is a good example, with due respect, my wife is Ekiti, so don't worry. Due respect to Ekiti, you know, a lot of us here, when we were going to have the Ekiti elections, couldn't really understand why a Fayoshe would be picked above a Fayemi. And I kept telling people that Fayoshe is going to win. He's going to win because if you look at the results that come out or that have been coming out from Ekiti, when you have results where majority of your people are failing their exams, are failing their O-levels, for example, it means you are creating a new breed of people, and then the majority, their values are different. You're talking values that they don't connect with. And I said, if they run those elections over and over again, Fayose would win. He would win over and over again. Because a lot of those that are voting for him are thinking completely different from the way you think. Somebody was in Ekiti on the day of when they announced, when he was sworn in. He said, Jimmy, I've never seen that kind of thing before. And I said, what? He said, he actually opened the government house. I said, you know this house? It's your own. It is yours. And they went in, everybody, the swimming pool, inside the house. That is your own, he said, yes. And the policemen could not, said, no, it's their own. But they met with that. Yes, it is our own. So, any day he goes out there, they're going to be with him anyway. But all these big people, you know, he brought it down to our level. So, these are issues. So it's the same way that you want to bring about entrepreneurship. You want to bring about people setting up small, medium enterprises. They must have some kind of net, knowing that when all else fails, life will not fail. But the idea that you're going to lose everything, you're going to lose life, health, education, everything, it does not help in innovation. Because it is like, you know, at 50 plus, 60 plus, now Opeyemi is hitting 50, their risk is not likely to take any longer because he knows that to cover may be difficult. And that's how it is for a young man of 25. It's still a risk when he doesn't have anything to back him up. But if he goes, I remember setting up my own practice. My wife was working. I knew she had a salary. I had a child then who was in school. And I said, well, 2 years, I should be able to pay myself. In any case, if I couldn't pay myself for those 2 years, what we're living on would survive. So I could take the risk. But if I had children, or it was a different setting, I probably wouldn't set up at that time. So these are some of the things that we need to begin to put in place in terms of providing opportunities for our people. I won't mention the bold ideas part. So in conclusion, I'm not sure that my conclusion fits into what I have here. Then, maybe in conclusion, I'll just say that, is there hope? I say yes. So it's not all bad. If anything, what Jonathan did a few days ago gives us hope. I don't know how many of you know how close Nigeria was to going up, boom. All Jonathan needed to do was to sit down and do nothing. And you know, like in every government, you have the hawks ready to move. And so he didn't even wait for the results to be complete. Because if he had waited, it may have been too late. And decided that I'm going to leave a legacy that is different from what they want to push me into. And so it took a man of character to say, what am I going to be remembered for? If nothing else, let me be remembered that I made this work. And so for me, there's hope. I will just continue to pray that we'll be able to do a lot more of that in different ways, in ways that after a while, we can say that our bottom line is not about whether Nigeria will exist or not. Because presently, still, will it exist? Will it not exist? I know how many people here have their wives abroad now and their children. Yeah, because they were not sure what was going to happen. And I'm serious. Where's your wife? She's over there. Me, I will cross border. Even for us, I will confess, my visas are complete. Yes, my visas are complete because I'm not the one that blew it up. So these are the realities that after a while, when that is no longer the issue, it's no longer an issue of will Nigeria survive or not, then we can say that our democracy has come to stay. Then we can begin to guarantee governance in the way we should guarantee it. But then, in whose court is it? Is it in the politicians or is it in your court? Ladies and gentlemen, it's more in your court than in the politicians. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir, for providing further insight into democracy and governance issues in Nigeria. We are so glad to have you around. Thank you, sir. On a final note, I'd like to make this announcement that the launch price for each of these books is 5,000. However, you are free to purchase above that price, and you are at liberty to make donations to the publisher for providing this contribution to knowledge and society. Now we will have a very short cake cutting ceremony, which will precede the vote of thanks.
You know, this job he gives me makes it more difficult for people to believe I don't have any blood in this man. Anyway, really to a fine gentleman, passionate about whatever he believes in. You don't have to agree with him, but he keeps going. Opeyemi, well, yes, and then Mrs. Agbaje. Okay, there are two Mrs. Agbajes. Well, the original Mrs. Agbaje in this case. I suppose, no, just two of them.
Okay.
We'll just support. Well, 50, I think we'll count to 50. I'll say, and welcome you to the club. 10, 20, 30, 40, 45, 46, 47. You see how long it takes to count your age now? Very long. That shows how old you are. 47, 48, 49, 50. Well, I told his birthday is really one on Monday, but I don't think it's out of place. We believe God that he has seen today and that he will see Monday. And since all of us will not be there on Monday, some will, but not all of us as a group, I think we owe it to at least sing happy birthday to this 50-year-old boy.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Opeyemi. Happy birthday to you. May the good Lord bless you. May the good Lord bless you. May the good Lord bless you. Amen. May the good Lord bless you.
Happy birthday in advance. Thank you.
Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, we will bring this event to a close with a vote of thanks by the celebrants and CEO, Mr. Opeyemi Agbaje.
Thanks again, but let me start by talking about the books. I'm not going to spend more than 10 minutes, but there's a book review there. First on Uncomplex strategy, like Professor Legido said, most of the articles in those books, or most of the content in those books, were developed while I was teaching business strategy at the Lagos Business School. And both the democracy book and the strategy book. And I must say, in relation to the democracy without Democrats book, that the reason I had decided who was going to make this presentation or this lecture maybe 4 years ago, I knew it was Opeyemi Agbaje, because in my view, he was an example of somebody who was a Democrat. So I assured Jimmy that the reason I asked him to speak on democracy without Democrats was to offer him as an example of what a Democrat was supposed to be. But back to the real job. So my first thanks goes to Jimmy Agbaje. I call him Egbo, but I also immediately tell everybody that we're not related. But he's been like a brother. And when I told him about this, which was maybe just before we went public, I told him, I've already committed you to something. And he just said, what is it? And he immediately said, okay, let me put it in my diary immediately. So JK, Egbon, Jimmy Agbaje, Mr. Agbaje, all the other things, all the other appellations that people call him. Thank you very much for doing this. I also like to thank Mrs. Agbaje, his wife. She's also been so kind and so friendly and so much of, also of a sister to me. I must thank the panelists, all of them. Adedoyin Odufa, who was in Geneva when I sent her an email, and she just replied, I'll do it. Thank you very much. My brother Rashid, he didn't allow me to finish my sentence. Immediately I called and said, Rashid, I'm doing this. He said, no, anyhow you want it, anyhow you want it. And immediately I agreed. We go back a long way. We were in IFE together, we were in GT together. We were in LBSC MBA class together, and we were still together. So thank you very much, Rashid. Mezo Umuneli, I've met more recently, but I tend to like people like him. So that's why I took to him almost immediately. He was on my TV program. He was a fantastic guest, and he was a fantastic panelist again today. Thank you, Mezo. Tosin Rushewe has left, but we also go back a long way. He was our junior, our bureau in university, and he was our bureau in GT, but he's now no longer our bureau. So he's doing it very well, and I'm proud to be associated with Tosin. I must say particular thanks to Larietta, and indeed beyond Larry, to the whole of the UAC crowd that are here and that we've been together for 8 years, like you said. In Nigeria, things don't happen the way my relationship with Larry happened. You know, a large group doesn't just retain you to work with them simply because they thought we had never met before them. It was simply a proposal we sent to UAC. We were invited to do a presentation in Ibadan at IIT. We did the presentation. The UAC people were very happy. And immediately, Larry, who was then an executive director about to become CEO, immediately became MD. He offered us with retainership. And we've done well together since then. So thank you. And for those of you, I can hint you that there's indeed a UAC dimension to the book. So I use a lot of examples around in sectors around UAC businesses. And when I talk about corporate social responsibility, I don't do it with a theoretical framework. I do an article called Can Companies Do Good? And that was a case study of the UAC group. So thank you very much, Larry. Thank you, UAC. I see your staff, Soa, Mukta, Abdu, Velo, Mr. JIG. Thank you all very much. And the FD of PPPNL, I think I also saw him. Again, I mean, Professor Elehido, Dr. Enase Ekonedo, the Lagos Business School, I've already mentioned the LBS dimension. I thank them for offering the environment after my days in banking, in which I became an academic and possibly also became a consultant. Of course, I should mention my wife, Oluwatoyin, and my sister, Moreni Keji, and my staff, all the staff of RTC. I think Moreni Keji Adepoju should please stand up for recognition. That's my oldest sister. All of us, all the rest of us are in different parts of the world, so she's the one who is able to join us today. And all my staff, the colleagues, the hotel, they've been fantastic. The media people, I see Edibi, who is probably the highest place, Eniola Bello, for those of you who don't know who Edibi is. It's my brother, it's my friend, but he's also the managing director of Disney Newspapers. And of course, there are many other media people in the room. I want to thank Mr. Oshibodu and Mrs. Oshibodu and Mr. Phillips and Dr. Oshin and many other great people. I'm thoroughly impressed by Harun Ojalo Waziri. I've only met him once before. He's an executive director at the Nigerian Stock Exchange. We were on a panel together doing this kind of thing, and he has been here from the beginning. The BOI team, Wahid Olagunju, Alhaji Abdulganiu, there's a gentleman in between whose name I don't quite remember, but there's a strong, okay, Mike, there's a strong BOI team supporting Rashid. Most of all, I want to thank this great panel, this great audience. It's tough in Lagos the day before Easter to come to Ikoyi. There was a lot of traffic. I also know that there's a lot of people who are abroad. I know that from inviting people here, and all the apologies, I go, I'm sorry, I'll be in London, I'll be in America. So for those of you who choose to stay in Nigeria and to risk an election that could have gone another way, and indeed to show up today, I want to thank you very much. So.